There we go. Getting ready.
I didn't know if I was going to sit somewhere the other day. I had to wait for something because I had to sign between things.
All right, well, it's quarter after. We'll get started. Case again, cash. I'm Jacob Buller. I'm with ecovillages.ca. I'm not sure exactly how long this is going to go. It could be if we get through it in an hour, we might be done by then. Otherwise, we might go until 90 minutes. I'll take a look at 45 minutes in to see where we're at. And if there's 5 minutes left or 45 minutes left, and based on that, then we might break for five for smoke or breath or whatever you want. I'm the editor of that newsletter, the co-creator, and the founder of of that website, ecovillages.ca. I've put together a PowerPoint and a discussion then on ecovillages, their concepts, and a little bit more about some of the local ones, as well as we'll take a look at Twin Oaks, which is, has anyone heard of Twin Oaks? No, familiar? I love that community. I love what they've got going there. We'll take a look at it to see what they've got and whether it fits in. So the introductions. So this has been a family thing for me. This is my wife and my son Arthur. Arthur is about 3 and a half. Julie and I have been visiting different eco villages since about 2013, trying to figure out what works for our family, as every family is different and has its own needs, right? We've been to over half a dozen different communities in the U.S. and Canada. These include in Manitoba, Northern Sun Farm, Plowshares, and I was directly involved with Myriad for some time as well, Kakwa in B.C., and a whole village in Ontario, rounded out our Canadian journey. During Christmas, we visit my parents who live in Virginia, and we have had the pleasure of visiting Twin Oaks, as well as a couple of surrounding communities, Acorn and Cambia. So both Julia and I grew up in the country, and we really feel that it's important for Arthur in his formative years to be in the country and to be able to enjoy nature. So that's a few things that are important to us. It's given us a chance to talk about what we like and what we will leave for other people as well. I want to give a brief story about the origins of this endeavor. In 2012, my wife-to-be, Julia, decided to go to Europe with a couple other couples. And in that journey then, we also went to a psytrance festival called Boom in the Portuguese desert. And it was a real eye-opening experience in terms of collaborative culture. In Portugal, in that psytrance festival, it was 20,000 people from over 100 different countries. And in Paulo Coelho's The Alchemist, he talks about the soul of the world, and that's kind of what I felt connected to there when I enjoyed that the experience there of Boom. It was just eye-opening, right? You know, it's that sort of experience. It's like at Folk Fest, we'll get a really good vibe there. Then Boom just takes it and blows it out.
What's that name again?
Boom.
Boom.
Just
B-O-O-M.
Boom. Yep.
B-O-O-M. Okay.
It's, they call it a transformational culture festival. And it's often referred to as the Burning Man of Europe. Art installations everywhere. I could give half an hour just on that. I don't have time for that. So it was there that I experienced that global community. And that was when I came home. I wanted to figure out how to bring that home. This was one of the, my family saw this when we visited Whole Village in September of last year. So this workshop is my way of thinking globally, but acting locally. It's been a search, our research project for 5 years. And our introduction, our first website, our first eco-village was Kakwa in BC. The second one that we went to was actually Twin Oaks in Virginia. It wasn't until after I saw Twin Oaks that I started researching eco-villages in Manitoba and thought, I realized, actually, we had Northern Sun Farm and other local communities. It's like, this is pretty cool. So that's kind of how I got into it. I started blogging about my family's trip and our journey there, and I am a firm believer in a pedagogical approach where we share what we learn and we help each other out. That's where I'm coming from. So whether you join a community or create one, the information here I hope will help you. And even if you're just loosely interested, it'll give you something to go on. Whole Village is where that's where my wife and I are currently pursuing a membership. What we got here? So they have a 20,000 square foot residential facility where it's 11 different residents in there with multiple with different numbers of the bedrooms in. So anywhere from 1 to 5. And then there's common living space in there as well. So they do community breakfasts. They have an Airbnb that sits out over here. And that's where my family stays in the Airbnb. CSA agriculture in here. This was the original homestead that was, people still live in there. I think it's mostly the single people that live there. And then there's families that live there. They've been around since, Whole Village has been around since 2000. I think officially they signed their papers in 2006. And they've done a lot of work with permaculture and employing permaculture in the establishment of their community. So they do a, when we were there, we met people who had lived in a community called The Farm in Tennessee. They had been, come on, sit down, there's coffee back there if you wanted as well.
Thanks. Speaking of that one, The Farm,
yeah.
About how many people are there now?
At The Farm?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't know. but it's, I learned about it reading Ina May's Guide to Childbirth before Arthur was born. And it's just like being a birther community. That was really cool. It's just like.
Yeah. I first learned of it in the 70s.
And yeah, okay.
It was the biggest I knew of in North America. At the time, there was about 500 people.
Wow, there's more now. Mm-hmm. More
okay.
than that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I was wondering if it had grown or shrunk or what. Yeah.
Where did you see the ones?
Tennessee is where the farm is. So, and one of the other things that I enjoyed there was just some of the kids there would. What they did is they just wandered around the land. That idyllic child is something that I want my son to have. And I think this is something that's important. And if other people can make use of what I'm doing in that endeavor, let's do it. So yeah, let's see. Next one. Twin Oaks. My family visited this past Christmas. Christmas time, we go to visit my parents in Virginia, and we had an opportunity to check out Twin Oaks as well as Cambia. We stayed the night in a camp, right? Manitou kind of thing. It was empty, and it was the whole trip was an adventure.
It's been, we met new people, there came via that I had not had a chance to connect with before. They're doing, I'll get more into Cambia, I think, a little bit later, but they're doing, they also have a very permaculture-based background where they're building a community with very specific focus on children, because they have a five-year-old and there's other parents there that, so what they're doing is they're appealing to the families, more parents, that's a good thing. But Twin Oaks is, it's a community where it's possible to just live. You get into it, and you can integrate with the outside world if you want. You don't have to. You can also just live your life, which is really fascinating. It's easy to live without technology there if you don't want it. If you do, you can use it. They have public computers for people to use, or you can have it use your own computer. It's all really what you want. They're also, I'll get to a little bit more about this in a moment, they're a big proponent of consent culture. When I was there for New York, New Year's Eve, they have a party at Acorn called New Year's Eve Eve, and then at Twin Oaks, and they have their big New Year's Eve party. And the New Year's Eve Eve thing was a workshop on consent culture and how to get people, how to help people relate to each other in a more consensual manner, which I found was, this is cool. This is just, I'll tell another quick story here. And this is just one of the reasons why I started kind of taking some of this stuff more seriously. During one of my trips back from visiting my parents, I went through O'Hare Airport, and I was standing in the terminal waiting to get on. Around me is just, it's all suits and ties. And then this other guy walks by, and he's got long blue hair, a piano tie, bright red pants, and an orange jacket. It's just like, I gotta ask this guy, what do you know about her? Like, who are you? What's your thing? Well, when I was introduced to Patch Adams. And I did not realize that he had actually written the introduction to Creating a Life Together. That's that book that I have sitting outside. So that synchronicity for me was something that said, all right, pay attention. So that's what I'm trying to do. So, what is an eco-village? Robert Gilman, founder of the Context Institute, did a lot of research back in the 90s, and his definition there is that it's a human-scale, full-featured settlement in which human activities are harmlessly integrated into the natural world in a way that is supportive of healthy human development, and can be successfully continued into the indefinite future. Kasia Joubert, then she's also part of the Global Ecovillage Network, a larger network. Come on in. There's coffee here for you if you want to. So there's many different networks. There's the, if you get into, that's actually one of the things that Twin Oaks is found with some of those networks. Eco-villages can be urban and rural. For our conversation today, we'll be focusing on rural. When I visited Twin Oaks a year ago, there is a panel at Acorn that I attended that was Point A. Point A is a network of urban communities in the D.C. and Boston area. So there's networks everywhere, and there's also urban eco-villages as well. I am personally not all that familiar with them. I'm more familiar with the rural. But with this information here, a person could certainly move forward and create an urban one, too. I like to look at eco villages as being human beings. Each one is unique with its own character. Sometimes there are well integrated ones, and sometimes there are ones with many different parts moving in many different directions. So it's up to you to figure out which one you want to live in. The community movement started in the 60s. Northern Sun Farm formed in the late 70s. Twin Oaks has been around since 1967. And it's also kind of gotten easier to create them too, because in the 60s and 70s when they were creating these, they didn't have things like the internet or cell phones, Microsoft Word or Excel, or even our most recent technologies like Kickstarter or Instagram. It was a very different environment for creating these things when they first came out. So, purposes and alternate names. Concepts behind eco-villages include that they tend to be very agrarian. Rural eco-villages are based on organic farming, permaculture, other approaches which promote ecosystem function and biodiversity. Whether urban or rural, they integrate community and ecological values with a principle-based approach to sustainability, such as permaculture design. An intentional community, then, would be kind of like taking a step back from eco-village and saying, okay, this is a planned community. They're designed from the start to have a high degree of social cohesion and teamwork. And the members of one typically hold common social, political, religious, or spiritual visions, and often follow an alternative lifestyle. They typically share responsibilities, resources. They also include collective households, co-housing communities, co-living eco-villages, monasteries, communes, survivalist retreats, kibbutzim, ashrams, and housing co-ops. New members are generally selected by communities' existing membership, rather than by a real estate agent or landlord. This is information straight from Wikipedia. This is stuff that you can access as well. Common philosophies. We often hear sharing is caring. That's very common. Twin Oaks is a founding member of the Federation of the Egalitarian Communities. It's a network of egalitarian, so it's a network of values, right? Ecologically sensitive. There is a lot of feminism in them. There's shared values in the community, shared resources. This is Northern Sun Farm. That is actually their cold storage. They have a common cold storage, and that is water then for their fields, for their gardens, I should say. That picture there is from Twin Oaks. That is their car sharing program. Twin Oaks, they have a car share program, so that if you want a car, you have them. You don't have to worry about the ownership of it. That's a picture from also from Twin Oaks, from their women's, they have run a women's conference every year. Where it's all about empowering women. And that's a shared kitchen there in Cole Village. There's some open concept style with lots of room to work because it's a community kitchen. So they're value based. There's a lot more outdoors. There's a less focus on technology because, generally speaking, in these communities, it's going to be more about face-to-face. It's going to be about interacting in face-to-face relationships. They focus on community. There's shared meals. At Northern Sun Farm or Twin Oaks or Cold Village, there's shared meals. Shared tools as well. So common philosophy. Why community? Now I'm going to start referencing from the books here that I have for sale outside there. They're finding community. is a book by Diana Leaf Christian about, she visited over 100 different communities throughout the U.S. and around the world, I should say. Her books are found in almost every community of Iskut. They're kind of the books to know, to read about communities. So this is her list. So for more environmentally sound, I think it's a lot of this is very common to us as we want to think about why we're getting into them. It's safer, it's healthier. Twin Oaks uses an average of 10% the carbon of the average American household. In her book, Diana talks about how much she feels much safer in the community as a woman. Openness and trust is cultivated in these communities between residents. It's healthier. Research shows that people live healthier lives if they have many social connections, especially as they get older. It's cheaper. Shared resources and an economy of scale reduce the cost of living. It's not nearly as it's about ownership. Something is owned by the community, you're able to support that thing. It's more satisfying. You can experience a sense of connection and support with like-minded friends and colleagues. When you grow as a person, you will undoubtedly become more self-aware and possibly more tolerant and compassionate. You'll learn better communication skills and will become better at participating in meetings. You can learn new skills, and you'll probably also develop more confidence. Self-confidence. It's more fun. You can experience many different, her words, you can experience the child's delight of sharing life's pleasures with friends. Common fears about joining.
Could you say your name again?
Diana Leaf with the L-E-A-F-E and Christian. Are incredible. She also does workshops, and she is a facilitator as well. She can do Skypes with people. I did do a Skype with her, and I learned some really interesting things that I'll get to in a bit. She's got a wealth of knowledge, and she does a lot of workshops and seminars on Eagle Villages around the world. So, fascinating stuff. Not wanting to live out in the boonies is a very common fear, and it was part of the criteria for Myriad Village when they were selecting their land, so that was no farther than 90 minutes away from them. Keeping Winnipeg within driving distance was a key part. So not only do most of them live in Winnipeg, but they didn't want to be too far or to be a drawback to their potential members as well. This was similar to Northern Sun, but it was no further than 30 minutes away from Steinbach. And it's actually a little bit of a challenge with Kakwa, because when I visited Kakwa, we actually had to take a train in and stop in between Jasper. It stopped like 2 hours outside of Jasper to let us off in the mountains. And they wouldn't let us off. It was dark, because there's bears in the area as well. Mm-hmm. So it's a very remote ecosystem. So it makes it hard for aspirants, people who want to check it out.
Which one is that?
Kakwa. K-A-K-W-A. Another common fear is that people don't want to live with a bunch of hippies. Well, there may be a few, but that's definitely not the majority. At least not in the communities that I visit. This is also, I sense it's becoming more of a cultural norm as well, where it's with our different TV shows that have them, it's not quite as a weird thing anymore. Mm-hmm. That is starting to become more socially accepted. So on BBC 4, there's a little clip that I'll play a little bit later from BBC 4 as well. People who live in communities also tend to be hardworking and responsible. It's because that's what makes these communities work. I don't want to live a poverty-consciousness lifestyle with limited resources is another comment here. There's very different set on standards of living between different communities. Myriad is in their formative stage. They've got yurts and campers, and people love it. That's what they want right now. Then you go to some place like Northern Sun Farm. There is individual houses. Each house then has a solar panel and a well, so it's off-grid houses there. You go to some place like Twin Oaks then, and it's been established for 50 years. There's dorm-style living. They have half a dozen different social enterprises that people work for their own internal economy. And people there have a very different quality of life. That's one of the big things about Twin Oaks is the quality of life is like living, having a seven-figure salary. But everyone there makes less than, they live underneath the poverty line in Virginia. So it's a play. It's interesting. At Northern Sun, they have shared sauna, they have shared tools. The community has a line on the wood-fired stoves that they used to keep and cook with. There are, private ownership is one of those things. It's like they really turn the idea of private ownership on the head. That it's not as, you don't have to own something to have access to it. You can still have dual libraries, things like that. Car shares. Well, I don't want to live with things about the cultural types who are trying to avoid responsibility. People who live in community, they live in that community because it offers an alternative way of life from mainstream society, and many community members still will raise families, maintain and repair facilities, or they work for a living. People in Northern Sun Farm still work for a living. They don't have to work as hard or as much, but they still do. People still pay income and property taxes. Some people might even argue that living in an eco-village community is actually more socially responsible than what we have. Also, I don't want to have to join a religion or take up some spiritual practice I don't believe in. Once again, you choose what you want to move into and out. On the database of intentional communities, at ic.org, in 2006, 45% they had a shared spiritual path, which means more than half don't actually have a shared spiritual path that they practice. I don't want to live in a hierarchical system or follow a charismatic leader. Not many actually use a hierarchical system. It's usually democratic. And Myriad uses a form of consensus. Twin Oaks uses a participatory democracy where every voice is heard. And Northern Sun also uses consensus. So power that's one of the challenges that is very crucial to think about in the forming on how decisions are made. Because that can be a very common problem. I don't want to have to think like everyone else. Well, if it turns out to be a cult. Fortunately, you don't have to drink the Kool-Aid. It's part of the visitation period, especially for the more established ones, where you get to know them, and they get to know you. Twin Oaks has a three-week visitation where you come and visit first, and then you leave, and then they come back after. They say, all right, we like you, come check us out for a year. Or is it 3 months? So then you come back for 3 months and you get to really know each other. And then you leave again. And then it's after that, then the community decides whether or not they want you. So it's not just it's chill, right? Because it's not, if you're chilled, they're going to be chilled. They're going to like that. Community members don't live in a hive mind. They all, and that's one of the things, is they usually have wildly different opinions, different approaches. How to be successful? I think I'm creating one. It's from her book, Creating a Life Together. 90% of them fail. This percentage is actually the same as, say, any mobile app startup. 90% of those at startups fail as well. It is a common issue in all communities. Here's what to do to stay informed and ahead of the game. Know that structural conflict is common. We're human beings, not telepathic like Professor Xavier. So you want to identify your community vision and create the vision documents. If you're visiting or want to ask good questions, ask to see these. Ask to see the vision documents. The community hasn't already shared it with you. The Myriad Village has pamphlets with it. Both Northern Sun and Myriad Village have their visions and missions on the document on their website. That's where it begins. That's the picture that everyone comes together if they want to see in the community. The conflict tends to come from the underlying differences about what the community is for. So all community members need to be on the same page from the beginning and must know what the shared vision is and know that you all support it. So it's all about talking, it's about communication. And to choose a fair and participatory decision-making process appropriate for your group. And if you choose consensus, you get trained in it. Many communities practice a pseudo-consensus and don't fully understand the process, and that causes many problems as well. Resentment over power issues can be an enormous source of conflict in community, and with decision-making being the most obvious point of power. The more it is shared and participatory, the less this kind of conflict will come up. Also make clear agreements in writing. Land use, the land should be owned in the appropriate legal entity. This includes the choosing that appropriate legal entity for owning the land. In Myriad's case, initially there is a sentiment of just buying land and everything would work out. They took a step back from that and began to figure out what it is that they wanted. They took a lot of time and research and conversations with Co-op Manitoba, but eventually they got a legal entity formed. For what they wanted, a for-profit marketing co-op was a legal structure that made the most sense. In the event that the group dissolved, the land would be sold off. And agreements should be written down. That's another good question to ask with this. How do you